Hi, Craig. Thanks for being here today. There's a lot going on out there in the big wide world, economically speaking, as well here at home. We're going to focus today on, or start off anyway, about Canada and where you see the Canadian economy evolving over the rest of the year and maybe next year as well. What's your take on economic growth?
So the last quarter of last year and the first quarter of this year, the Canadian economy effectively stalled. The pace of growth over those two quarters was an annualized 0.2-0.3%. I actually think this painted a worse than realistic picture of the Canadian economy. I think things were actually better than the aggregate numbers were showing. And in fact, when we looked at the details of the first quarter, you could see that domestic demand was rising, that consumers were spending, that businesses were investing more. But because of other factors, it dragged down economic growth. Now, right. In the second quarter, the data we've had has been actually quite strong. It's been very broad-based. The last three monthly GDP numbers have been quite solid. Mm-hmm. And it's currently tracking economic growth of around 3% annualized in the second quarter, which is very robust. Having said that, the second half this year probably isn't going to be as strong as the second quarter. I think that the economy is going to moderate. So what we're getting in Canada is a lot of volatility in the quarterly numbers. And I think when it all washes out, this year economic growth is probably going to come in at around sort of 1.5% or thereabouts, right?
You mentioned that a really good performance, quite robust, in this quarter, around 3%. That's awesome, right? Where's the strength coming from?
So a lot of it is a rebound. So we had for the first 2 months of the quarter, it was really concentrated in the energy sector. Right. So as you might expect, the drop in oil prices we had late last year and then the oil production curtailment that was put in place in Alberta, this really pushed down the energy sector in terms of the volume of output. And that's how we measure economic growth, right? That we have to stress that when we're measuring growth, what we're really talking about is the volume of goods and services produced, right. not the price. So the volume really dropped in the energy sector earlier this year. Now it's come back up. In addition to energy, the manufacturing sector has done a little better. But one of the big stories has been the stabilization in real estate. Mm. So what we're seeing is the markets where there are corrections, so in Vancouver and in Calgary-Edmonton corridor, the corrections are abating. Sales are starting to come back up. Prices are the contraction in prices is coming back to around zero. So the market is stabilizing. Meanwhile, in Southern Ontario, the Greater Toronto market, the country's largest real estate market, activity's really picked up again.
Yeah.
And so what we can see is that the real estate sector and construction isn't acting as a drag like it was over the last 18 months.
So we've talked about the strengths, let's do the SWOT analysis. Where are the weaknesses? Where do you see the weaknesses going forward? Why are we going to slow in the second half?
So I think there's a combination of factors. The first one is that heavily indebted Canadian consumers are not spending at a really strong pace. I mean, it's going to be solid, the wallets will be open, but the pace of spending growth is going to be constrained by what's happening to personal income. And right. And wages are rising, but they're not booming. So consumers will be spending, but the pace of spending growth will be moderate. And that's 60% of GDP. Right. Beyond that, I think that the manufacturing system in Canada, which is improving, is happening at the same time that we've seen global manufacturing stall. So we've actually seen the global economy is decelerating. Yeah. And if you look at global purchasing manager indexes of production, they're now actually below the 50 mark, and 50 is break even for growth. So anything below that, the manufacturing sector is declining. Mm-hmm. And certainly in Europe, we're seeing the manufacturing sector decline. We're seeing the impact of protectionism impacting global trade. So outside of Canada, we've seen more weakness in the manufacturing sector. And I don't think the Canadian manufacturing sector is immune from that.
Right.
And I think we will start to import more of the global weakness. The US economy also is likely to lose some momentum. And I think that's one of the reasons why our manufacturing system has been outperforming.
So you mentioned subpar growth on the year, about 1.5%. What, if you're a policymaker, what could you focus on to really start to try to boost that?
Well, in the long run, I think what we really need is a focus on competitiveness. What we actually need to is improve the performance of the Canadian economy and respond to the fact that on the international rankings, Canada's actually steadily losing ground. And some of it is because of actions we've taken, which is impeding competitiveness. And in some cases, it's because other countries are actually moving faster and farther in terms of boosting their competitiveness, right? So a good example of that is the drop in U.S. taxes. You know, Canada lost a very big tax advantage to the United States.
Yeah.
But when you look at competitiveness, it's very multifaceted, right? So Deloitte did a study on competitiveness, and we looked at all the different dimensions of competitiveness. Like, our strongest area is human capital. We have a highly educated workforce, very sophisticated workforce. But we do have an issue that we actually don't have enough workers. We have labor shortages, right? And that's actually deterring investment. So we actually need to improve skills that workers have so they better match what businesses need. But the areas where we're weakest is actually innovation, regulation, and taxation. And amongst the three, the one that we think is actually the greatest challenge is actually regulation.
Regulation. So give me an example of a regulation that is hindering our competitiveness.
Sure. So when you look at, compare Canada internationally, we were really surprised to find that across the OECD, which is the sort of embodiment of all of our peer advanced economies, Canada actually has the most restrictive policies on foreign investment.
Right.
And yet Canada is a very small economy.
Yeah.
And we know that investment has to be funded by savings. And if there's not enough domestic savings to meet the demands of investment, well, that means you need foreign investment, you need foreign funds to contribute to the Canadian economy. So you actually want to have policies in place that makes Canada an attractive place to invest. We've seen issues in Canada on the regulatory front around difficulty getting national infrastructure projects done. And people might immediately leap to the example of pipelines,
right,
because it's gotten so much attention, but this goes far beyond pipelines, right? This has to do with, like, how long does it take us to get approval to expand port capacity so that we can actually do more exporting abroad,
right?
And you know, in one case, one of our major ports, it's going to take us close to 10 years to get approval to actually build the expansion, right? So this is the sort of thing that restrains investment, it dampens economic growth. Now, when it comes to regulation, though, the purpose of regulation is to serve the public interest, right? You don't necessarily want just pure market outcomes.
Right.
That might not serve the outcomes that Canadians want. But what you need is regulations that defend the public interest, but at the least economic disruption.
Right.
And there's a lot of room for improvement on that front, including new regulations around rapidly growing new technologies, right? We don't actually have the regulatory environment we want to unlock the full potential of AI, blockchain, data analytics. There's a lot of challenges that policymakers need to tackle so that we can actually have a comparative advantage in that space.
Yeah, and it's speed. It's all about speed, because in 10 years, it'll be a different world.
Well,
port that's waiting for approvals, right?
And that's the real challenge. It's that the regulatory system cannot keep pace with the speed that the economy is changing at. And no government is doing this well, but Canada seems to be behind the pack, right? And so, you know, there's a real opportunity that if the federal government and provinces worked on this front, it could actually unlock a lot of economic potential. And the thing to stress is that if the economy is more productive, more competitive, ultimately that leads to a higher standard of living for Canadians. So this isn't just about businesses. This is actually about how do you make Canadians more prosperous.
So we have our own federal election coming up later this year. What's your expectation? Do you think the economy will figure large in the lead up to the election, during the campaign? And if you were Justin Trudeau, would you be comfortable running on your economic performance so far?
I think that the economic stats will be heavily cited by the current government, simply because, you know, they can say lots of jobs have been created, unemployment is close to a four decade low. So there's a lot of the economic statistics that I think the government will feel very comfortable, you know, using as a platform to say, you know, we've been good economic stewards.
Yep.
Now, having said that, I think the opposition parties are going to actually have a challenge characterizing mismanagement of the overall economy as being an election issue. But I think that there's certain files where I think you'll get more political debate and could become more of an election issue. So again, the example of difficulty getting national infrastructure projects done. Or, you know, it's the alternative, like, if you elect me, we will solve, you know, we will improve the economic outcomes even more than what you've had under the current government, I think is going to be more of the way the economy is going to feature. So I don't actually think the economy is going to be issue number one, but it's such a big issue, you can't ignore it entirely.
Right.